It's a great blessing for us to be with you, wherever you are, in this beautiful land of Guyana, in the riverine area, in the interior, in the coastland. We welcome you in the Caribbean and further afield. We pray as we share with you from the Word of God, you will gather your family around yourself, and you will sit down, relax, and enjoy as we speak to you from the Word of God, that you and your family will be blessed. Stay tuned. God bless you.
Last week, we started an interesting discussion on agreement in terms of the protection and care of our children. We established up front that children, they are not assets in the sense that we can view them as materials and something that can be used and manipulated. And therefore, we noted that they are wonderfully and faithfully made by God. And therefore, as a people, we have a responsibility of protecting and watching over our children, so we should not engage them in sexual activities, engage them in abuse, and we should not kill them, use them as chattels or vessels to create confusion and mischief. And therefore, this evening we want to go beyond identifying some of the things that we would have observed happening to our children, and we want to now look at the solutions. What are some of the solutions to the problems that we see existing in society in relation to our children? We have a tendency of just making children and releasing them and therefore into society, and when we do that, obviously we interfere with the balance of society, because those children, you know, they come into society short of values, short of economic, short of finance, short of education, and therefore that kind of situation really affect the society. So do you want to look at agreement this evening in the context as to how we can actually care, nurture, and share with our children? Gentlemen.
I agree with you, Pastor Hudson. Our children certainly need love. Our children certainly need healthy relationship. Our children certainly need affection. Certainly need attention, certainly need intimacy with their parents. And sometimes we feel that we can just bring them and drop them and leave them, and the strong will survive. They will just make it somehow. That's not possible, and that's not God's intent. You might creep through by the scruff of the neck, but that really is not what God intended. We should take good care of our children. You know, as I'm speaking, I'm remembering very vividly, so clear in my mind, an experience I had of having, because of my role and the nature of my work, having to help some, what's called by the law enforcement agency, to help. To bring some assistance to some young people who found themselves in conflict with the law, and because of their age, they really thought that they needed help. They needed some counseling, needed some clear guidance, they needed a father's instruction. So I was invited. And when I met them, there are two things that really registered to me that I don't think I would be able to forget until I die. I remember one case. There was one young person, a young woman. She's not 17. And she was so angry, so puffed up, so vexed with the world, that it must be God who caused me to say these few words to her. Among the things I said to her, I said, you know what? Every person who hurt you, every man who took advantage of you, today, I want to ask you for forgiveness. I take the responsibility of every evil and advantage that was taken on you, and today I ask you to forgive me. I literally made myself the scapegoat. And by doing that, I was amazed that this bravado, this badger, oh, instantaneously, as soon as those requests were made for forgiveness, he right away broke down in the presence of everyone and started to cry, violently cry. It seemed as if I touched the nerve that was dear for a while. I seem as if there's a hole, deep hole inside of her that really needed to be filled. There was a major void. And those simple words of forgive me did a number on her. Out of that same experience, the other side was, I give you one side, I give you the other. Because I believe that in our community, both from the family level and at the community level, we can impact our children. We can help them to become better. There was one young lady who was a part of the group who every time she came, she answered the call to report, came with a neighbor who was just concerned and thought that she would make herself available as a mother for this child. I personally wanted to say, I congratulated her several times and said, hats off to you, and God is surely going to repay you. But the issue still remains that our children and our youths do have a huge void, created sometimes by what is happening at home, by what the lack of love, the lack of affection, several things. And it is our responsibility to be conscious of what is happening and to help them. We just can't leave them there to die. They are our children. They belong to us as Guyanese. We need them. Gentlemen.
Of great concern. And this bothers me a lot because, like Paul declared, you know, when I was a child, I thought like a child. I acted like a child. Now I'm a man. You know, you behave differently. And I recall my childhood days. I really had the privilege of being a child, knowing what it meant to be a child, moving from one stage of development to another. I cannot say the same thing of our children today. I think because of so many different issues that they are faced with, they are forced into living the life of an adult, even as a child, and it puts unnecessary pressure on them. And so it behooves parents, and here I'm speaking to both mother and father, to understand the responsibility that they have to their children, to protect them, to nourish them, to care for them, to look after their well-being. You know, it is so amazing when you look at the way the animals treat with their young, you know, and you want to know why it is that us humans, why we behave as though, you know, there's no care or concern for those children that God would have blessed us with. So I want to call parents to a place where they would understand that they have a responsibility to their children to ensure that they are nourished, looked after, and well taken care of.
Yes, Proverbs, Psalms 31, you said of you, quote, you call a very important word, Psalms 131, verse 2, this is what it says. Instead, I have calmed and quieted myself like a little weaned child with his mother. I am like a little child. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, both now and forever. The concept in Psalms 131 is what I want to introduce to us. The concept of a child benefiting from breastfeeding from his mom. The care and the nurturing that takes place. How necessary that is. And then there's another phase of that child's development where that child has to be weaned so that the child will be able to stand on his own or her own, being able to survive without the sub. Both phases of that child's development, to my mind, are absolutely necessary. And if we as a people are to fail them in either of these two phases, then we are actually making life extraordinarily difficult for them. Let us ensure that in the phase of care, taking good care of them, nurturing them, giving them the resources that they need so that they become strong and healthy, the moral values, the spiritual strength, and don't just give them knowledge, give them a relationship. That's the only way they want to make it.
You know, how many of you would like to receive a reward right now? Most people, you know, everybody, you know, likes rewards. And because of the benefit that they perceive that, you know, the reward or rewards will bring to them. Therefore, people treat with rewards, you know, or rewards seriously. And Psalms 127 verse 3, just to hinge on what Pastor San is saying, it says that sons are a heritage from the Lord, children a reward from Him. Now, people do not throw away a reward. You do not crush reward. You do not, you know, treat reward lightly or anyhow, because you see it as a benefit coming to you. You know, you could imagine how somebody gave you a reward of $100,000, $300,000, $1 million. You feel nice. You feel excited. The same way you are to treat with our children, because this is a reward that was given to you by God. In other words, what we're saying here, what the Bible is saying, that children, they are a blessing, and therefore they ought to be treated in a certain way before you actually attempt to release them into society. And so the time has come when we must not see our children lying on the road corners anymore. We must not see them begging. We must not see them doing strange things because they want to survive, because they are your reward, and therefore we have to protect them. Not only the parents, but the society in general ought to protect them, because they came from God.
I love the concept that you spoke about, Pastor Hudson, about reward and not throwing away your reward. I believe generally we have a sense, as parents, we have a sense of responsibility. But I think the problem comes when somewhere along the line, because of current situation, because of current circumstances, we tend to negate that responsibility. We have to be able to stay in the whole process. We have to be able to, despite what prevailing circumstances, that we remember our God-given responsibility. Mm-hmm. And so that in itself will be a lesson to our children. They would have seen us when we go through hard times, and we're there for them. We love, we care, we protect. And so when that time comes for a change, for betterment, they will appreciate our love and our care, because they knew that from experience we were there with them to the end.
It's critical, it's important that we take the time to train, to teach, to nurture, to instill values. It will go a long way with our children, their life-lasting principles that we can teach our children. And it's so important that we understand our responsibilities as parents. When we fail to honor responsibilities, we leave them to the wars, we leave them to other people who will not, some people will take advantage of them, will abuse them. That young lady maybe was abused by so many people before, and inside of her was pent up feelings. And when Pastor Sana would have said, "Forgive me, I am taking the responsibility for all those people and forgive me," she broke down because of what had happened. now is the time for us to take our responsibility serious. Teach, train, that never stops. It is something that is continuous. We ought to continue doing those things for our children.
Can we say, as parents, is it going to hurt us to say sorry? As parents sometimes, to say forgive me. Does it hurt us sometimes to let our children know that we ourselves, we don't have all the answers? We sometimes don't know everything, but we're willing to work together. And in this partnership, once we work together, we are going to come through these difficulties. Can we actually do that?
I've done it several times, to say sorry to the children. Acknowledging the fact that I erred, I was wrong. And by doing that, the children will get to understand that you're not a counterfeit. You're real, you're flesh and blood. It's not just that daddy passing the instruction, daddy is perfect. But daddy has failed in several areas, but with the help and by the grace of God, daddy can improve. I like what Pastor Watson touched on when he spoke about how can we resolve the issue. I think the word hope sometimes is misplaced in terms of how it's used. Some parents hope that their children will do well. They hope that they will be assets to society. They hope that we'll achieve excellence. But parenting is really an intentional effort by all of us to really bring out the best in those children. It's a full-time occupation. Amen. It's a full-time job that we intentionally sit, walk, or stand up, and we teach and we train. We can't leave it up to chance and say, man, I hope that this child will come out good. So, like Pastor Watson said, if we understand that children are really a blessing, we understand their value, we understand the responsibility that God has given to us, then we will see them differently and don't treat them as though they are some asset to gain finances or to gain something that can benefit them.
You know, that's a tremendous sign, Pastor, of humility, of you actually saying to your children, I'm sorry. Yeah, and we really need humility in families, in the upbringing, because if the father gives the impression that, or the mother, that she's always right and everything that she does, everything that she says, or the same thing with the father, that child goes into a work environment believing that, I'm always right, and therefore conflict in the environment, when there's conflict, there could be no production, there could be no, efficiency in the organization. And so this whole thing about humility is so important for us to recognize that regardless of how high you be, how big you be in society, I think it is the strength of your character for a person to say, man, here's something, man. I made a statement and I am sorry because I recognize that this statement, it has far-reaching consequences. And so when children are taught that, they recognize that they're not supermen or a superman, and therefore in life you make mistakes, but making mistakes might be one thing. How you deal with those mistakes, that is critical to the process.
It is very important as a parent or a father to give compliments and to acknowledge. Whenever you as a parent see something is going wrong, you bring that wrong to the child and tell them, nurture them, and so that they will know that whatever they are doing, it is not right. Yeah. Likewise, you must give compliments. If they have done something good, pat them on the shoulder and tell them that you are well done. Keep on the good work that you are doing. And by doing that, you will see that society will be benefited. For instance, in later time, when they should go into marriage, they will go with expectations that might be fulfilled, or sometimes it does not fulfill. And because of the non-fulfillment of those expectations, breakup in marriage occurs.
My brother, you bring me to a very interesting question. The question is, can I give what I do not have? I have not been so exposed. I have not been so trained. As a matter of fact, I came from an abusive environment, you may want to say. And so how can I give what I don't? And it is for this very reason why I recommend that it is always good to start from the position of love.
Yes.
Always so powerful to start from the position of love. You know, there's a law of reciprocity that says, give, and it shall be given back unto you. Good measure, pressed up, shaken together, and running over. So could you imagine creating an environment of love? Creating an environment of respect? Creating an environment of affection? Creating an environment of attention and intimacy for your child, even though you may not have benefited from that? It helps you, because what happens? The law of reciprocity kicks in. And what happens? It starts to multiply. It starts to grow. So can we do it? Yes, we can.
In any agreement, you must have mutual understanding.
Yeah.
And I want to say to parents, I'm not bashing you, but especially to fathers, you need to have a clear vision for your family. It says children are given as a gift of God. Mm-hmm. I want to say my parents, they were given such 14 gifts. And they did not abandon any one of us. And we never had one day to go on the streets or beg anything. They were not rich people, but God blessed them. And they trained us up in the way that we should go.
Yes.
And I want to let you know that God did not bring us into this life without a purpose.
True.
And as parents, we need to help our children to find their purpose in life.
Amen.
And fathers, I want to say to you, you have a great responsibility, like how the mother is nursing the child and bringing that bond to that child. Fathers, your children need you. But you have weaned them a long time ago. You cut off everything from them. The resources that they need, the love that they need, the friendship that they need, you are not there. I want to encourage you today. As a good father, please find your way back home to these children.
You know, something happens when a child is being breastfed, you know.
Yeah.
A couple of things, and some of you out there can add to it. We have a bonding takes place where the child gets to know the mother, and the child recognizes the mother. So there is bonding. In that milk, and some doctors will tell you that is the best kind of milk for the child to receive at that particular point in time, because of the nutrients that are found in that milk. So the child can grow, the child can develop. You know, you need strong bones, strong teeth. You know, you need to develop
the immune system,
the brain is developing, so on. And so that is in the physical. Let's take that now into another realm. If you have a child and you are not imparting certain things in that child, you allow that child to become, you know, that child to be affected by his own ways, his own devices, so to speak. Obviously, that child's entire life will go down the drain, as my brother said. That, but you know what? Even though that child is going down the drain, that child's life has purpose.
Yes.
And because we are not doing what we're supposed to do in terms of how we teach, how we train, and how we deal with our children, we cause them not to fulfill purpose. And that brings us into direct contention with God. If you do not know, the Word of God clearly states that when we begin to treat children like this and they cry out to me, I will hear them.
Yeah.
And God says, and I will respond. And so we have to be mindful. You know, some of us, you know, sometimes we look at people and say, man, how they actually reach in this state and so on. I know some people who say, well, you better check and see what they used to do, you know, when they were much younger and so on. So as you get old, sometimes your sins do not catch up with you right away. Sometimes, you know, down the line, then, you know, God moves in on you. So one has got to be very, I'm not threatening anybody here, but I'm saying to you that you have to be mindful as to how you treat with the gifts of God.
Another important thing to take cognizance of is discussion. You know, it is so important that as family you sit together and discuss and talk things over, so that there won't be a fear between you and them.
Mm-hmm.
If they have problems, they will relate to you. They, rather than going to another neighbor or friend and relate their problem, they will come to you because of this regular discussion that you are having home over dinner or whatever, through a walk or sit over an ice cream, yeah. You know, and things like that. You can discuss family issues.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. Refuse, I want to say. Refuse. Speaking here now to the single people, those folks who believe that their biological clocks are really ticking, refuse to bring forth a child if you know that you don't have the requisite structure in place to rightfully care. Don't contribute.
Don't abort the child.
Refuse to contribute to the destruction that we see in society.
Amen.
Allow the values of the Word of God to take precedence in your life and raise a family in the fullness of time according to the principles of the Word of God so that we can have a better society.
I would like to encourage us that we should agree as a family, as a community, as a nation, that we will make deliberate, systematic deposits into the life of our children. And I'm not talking about just information, because there's lots of information out there. I am speaking about the relational transmission of life principles. And if you don't have such resources at home, I know God, being such a powerful God who He is always created environments where He will provide you a surrogate father, some great aunt, some uncle, somebody there who is able to give that what you missed in the environment you came from. But let it be such a deposit that when that child would have been mean, they can go to that bank and make some substantial withdrawals. Let it not just be living carefree. Let it not just be an opportunity to take advantage of. Let it be a time where we will, as a people, agree that we will deliberately make deposits. Now, if you make deposits in the bank, you know you can go to the bank at the right time, make the withdrawal. I pray that whatever you have deposited, the good things you have deposited will continue to grow so that they will have a successful and enjoyable life. God bless you.
We thank you for being part of Choices. Remember, you can join us at First Assembly for any of our regular weekly services. I am Salacia on behalf of the set, reminding you that your whole life is the sum of your choices. God bless.